Don is the technical lead from Microsoft, especially for the identity and the security. With over 20 years in Microsoft ecosystem, Don has been helping organizations modernize their security and identity concerns and assisting customers with their most complex identity challenges. Don focuses on solutions that empower customers to protect and detect advanced threats within their environments.
Perfect. Thank you again for that introduction, and welcome everyone. Good afternoon, good evening. We're going to kind of take a little bit of a different approach on this conversation and kind of give you just a new aspect. We're definitely going to talk about PAM and privileged access and what that means and what the future holds and where the industry trends are and just talk about why this is important. But we're also going to talk about some best practices. We're going to talk about how Microsoft implemented a privileged access management system for Microsoft IT. We'll talk about what are some of those best practices and lessons learned from that, as well as how can you quickly take advantage of this and at the end of this, more specifically within the Microsoft ecosystem of Azure and Microsoft 365, be able to apply some quick wins to come out with a little bit of an adoption of a privileged access management solution that can help you move forward with that. So you'll get a little bit of everything out of this. But really, to start, we do have to start with the foundations of identity, and we need to talk about what the challenges are for organizations with identity today. We heard a lot of it already, and it's amazing how often we're going to hear things like COVID impact on remote work and how that impacts our users and their identity and that access. But also, there's just an increase in being able to provide both security and organizational and user productivity at the same time. And it's a very, very thin line, a very hard line to walk along sometimes to be able to manage all of that. And so essentially what happens is we put identity as the control plane. This is what we have to do. We have to make sure that identity is central to everything we're accessing, because there's so many components that identity can play into that if we can harness that identity and manage that identity and secure that identity, we're already leaps and bounds ahead of where we were when we simply just had username and passwords, and we really didn't have this control over that user identity. Just to kind of speak to why this is so important, some of Microsoft's research and some of the data we've collected around identity attacks have been growing incredibly. You can look at these numbers and just see that that's a massive amount of data and opportunity for compromised accounts. And we, as we all know, compromised accounts is what we're trying to prevent, but they do happen, and we need to limit the risk if there is a user that is compromised within our environment. So some of those numbers, looking back just a couple months ago of this year, very high numbers and things around high-risk sign-ins for admin users. We have millions of compromised accounts on a monthly basis that we see, and this is going up. These numbers go up every month, every year, year over year. We're seeing more and more of this. So it's really important to think about where privileged access fits in our overall identity and access management solution, because gone are the days of simply giving someone a username and a password and assuming that they're everything's okay because they're locked behind our firewall. We're the only ones with the key and no one else is going to get in. We've got to really change the way that we look at that. So I know I don't need to tell anyone on this call what privileged access management is or PAM, but essentially PAM is both a tool, it is a solution you can deploy, but also just as important, it's a mindset. It's a mindset of understanding who are those privileged users in my environment, what is my privileged content, and how do I manage this and control this productively? Because really what we're looking at is a number of different problems in most organizations. So one, we're giving privileges to users that may never even need it. We're not really sitting down and saying, what does this user need? What role do they play in this environment? We're also giving users access, and we're never taking it away, which is even worse. And we'll see how that, in a normal environment, how that happens over and over again. And maybe you'll even reflect on your own environment and see how that happens quite often. The number of enterprise, the average enterprise Azure AD tenant has more than 12 global admins, which is pretty high. Microsoft as a whole, which manages millions of IDs and millions of devices, has 4, and not a single global admin has 0 standing access with our environment. So this is one of the ways Microsoft implemented their privileged access, and we'll talk more about that as we go to some of the best practices. And then, of course, the other alarming problem here is that privileges are only needed less than 25% of the time, and typically even far less than that. And we're not talking about just the time that user is actually at work. If this user works 40 hours a week, 25 hours maybe, but this is also where they're at home sleeping. That identity is just sitting there with keys to the kingdom, and we have no control over that if we're not implementing some sort of solution to help with that. So to carry on with what that problem actually is, what we see it typically happen, and we'll use Joe here as a user within our environment. Essentially, Joe says, hey, you know what, I need to do something with some privileged roles. I need to go manage Exchange. I need to set some forwarding rules and transport rules. So somebody says, well, the easiest thing to do is just give you a domain admin. I'm going to drop you in the domain admin group. Here we go. We're off and running. Joe goes and does his thing. He's completely done. Everybody forgets about it. Joe's now a domain admin in the environment, and nobody remembers it, right? So the idea there is, this is pretty common. The idea is that we want to be able to change that. We want to be able to do this a little bit differently. So instead, what happens now in the cloud is Joe says, hey, I need to be an Exchange Online admin. Well, we don't have... We have the ability to give you an Exchange Online admin role, but you know what, Joe, I'm just going to make you a global admin because this is just easy. It's really quick. Now I don't have to make sure you have all the rights you need. If you have to do something else, go for it. So in the cloud world, all we did is take what didn't work on premises and we moved it to the cloud. So it's simple as that. Now we have on-premises accounts that have too many privileges and we have cloud accounts that have too many privileges. So we're really just duplicating the process. So we need to find better ways to manage that. When we look at organizations, some of the critical data that we see is that over time, admins grow, but more importantly, their permissions grow. We very well might hire a new admin and they have a specific role in our environment, so we give them specific access that is limited. And then months go by and they need to do a task that's outside of that role. So we give them a little bit more. And then a couple months go by and we give them a little bit more. And this is the problem we've been doing for my entire career. I've seen in hundreds, if not more, organizations is just, hey, if you need it, here you go. We're going to give it to you little by little. And eventually, at some day, you are a domain admin or a global admin in these environments. But that's not what we want. What we want to be able to do is find a way to overcome that. One second, my slide is repeating. So what we want to be able to do is we want to be able to have time and not be a problem with how much privilege you have. So when we have a certain amount of permissions, we want to say that an admin is given those rights just in time, right? Just enough, just in time access. We want to make sure that if a user in my environment needs to be an admin, needs to perform admin activities, that I'm not just giving them to them and walking away. I'm giving them the specific amount of admin responsibility they need, the role they need with least privilege to do their job, and I'm time restraining it. I'm making sure that once they're activity is done or at a predetermined amount of time, they no longer maintain that access. So when they leave for the day, they go home, that user ID, if it gets compromised, has less risk in my environment than if it retained that global admin or security admin role in my environment. So I've mentioned why it's important. I think we've all heard that it's definitely important. I don't think you'd be on this meeting if you didn't realize how important this was. But a couple other key points to point out is just the overall risk. That's really what we're trying to do here is limit the risk. And also, we're doing this in different ways. A lot of organizations are implementing some compliances around NIST, for example. Microsoft has their own zero trust components and principles, as does NIST, and they're very similar in that sense. And it's important to learn about that and where privileged access management sits in a zero trust model. And again, I mentioned privileged access management as a mindset, but really zero trust is the mindset that we want to get to. We want to make sure that we have a zero trust mindset. I put this architecture in here for reference, so I won't go over that. But I want to talk about what zero trust really does and why it's important and what the three main principles, according to Microsoft, are for Zero Trust. Just as we heard a little bit in the previous session, the world's changed, right? We went from having users and employees and managed devices and on-premises applications, and everything was great behind our firewall, and all of this stuff worked well. We can inspect packets, we can analyze things, it was great. That's changed. We've exploded. The amount of users and access that are trying to get into our environments and access content and data in our cloud environments is just exploded. We have bring your own devices. This is just common. Even when we don't have defined policies, this is just happening. People are accessing corporate data from wherever they want on any device they want, and it's happening. And sometimes we don't even know it, and we need to be able to bring that in and make sure that we can control it. Obviously, the more cloud apps, the more control we need. We no longer have that perimeter as we saw. And of course, that explosion of single makes it almost impossible for the average enterprise or corporate organization to be able to analyze all of that data. They need help. They need tools. It's just too much. And so Zero Trust really just brings in three principles. And these are the three core principles that Microsoft put in their Zero Trust model, which is verify explicitly. The second one, use least privilege access. This is what we're talking about today. So this is a foundation to getting to a Zero Trust model. And then, of course, assume breach. I'm going to switch gears just a little bit, and I'm going to kind of focus this now on what Microsoft did within Microsoft's identity environment within Microsoft IT, and talk about some of those best practices on how you can kind of get some winning strategies in deploying a privileged access management solution. So there's a component in Azure AD called PIM, or Privileged Identity Management, which is a service in Azure AD that helps our customers manage those privileged access and manage access to those resources. What's more importantly is really where this came from. So the idea of privileged identity management came from Microsoft customers when Microsoft was becoming an online service provider, came to us and said, you know what, we need a way to meet compliances, one, but also a way to manage privileged identity. And we thought, okay, so does Microsoft. We don't have a way to manage this within our own environment. So Microsoft IT actually built the solution that we brought into Azure AD. So essentially, we created a solution where if a customer came to Microsoft and said, hey, I'm having trouble with your cloud solution, maybe I can't access this data file and I need it, it's very important, or it seems corrupted and I can't download it, and a Microsoft engineer needs to go access that customer content, well, we needed something in place to elevate that privilege. So in other words, the concept was no Microsoft employee has zero standing access to customer data. So we take that concept of now I have to escalate, I have to bring this to a management team inside of Microsoft. I need them to approve it. Then I need the customer themselves to say, yes, you can access my content. And then I need to make sure that they have the least privilege for just the amount of time they need access for. Then I need to be able to make sure that is all audited and controlled. So that's what Microsoft implemented behind the scenes to support our services, and then decided that we would bring this out to our customers and give them privileged identity management to help them with their scenarios. So what is privileged identity management? Essentially, everything we've just been speaking about, right? It's the ability for an average user to have the ability to do their day-to-day task, to read and consume the information they need to consume, get their job done until there comes a point where they need to do something more. And then they can ask for the ability to elevate their privilege, not log in as another user that has an admin privilege that's just sitting there waiting for them to log in, but actually elevate their current user to have these permissions for a period of time. And when that time is up, we automatically go back to being our normal user. We don't have to sign out and sign back in and forget that we're logged in as an admin. All of those challenges that happen when we try to manage everyday users and privileged users at the same time. So I've talked a lot about what privileged identity management actually means. It's also important to know what it does. So really, it's just-in-time privileged access to Microsoft 365 and Azure resources. So this is tied to Microsoft primarily, but this is what Microsoft presents to our customers to be able to have them implement a solution. The ability to have approvals is very important. Certain roles may not need approval. Certain users can go out and request what they need to access and just automatically grant it for that period of time. Maybe higher privileges need to be approved by certain users or groups within the environment. Of course, we need a way to govern that as well. So we need to be able to have access reviews that are part of this so that we know who has access to what, and they have just enough access, and they are the right access and the right applications and permissions that those users need. And we need to be able to review that and manage that. Of course, it's time bound, as I mentioned. We enforce multi-factor authentication. This is important. It goes back to that during the first session of how important multi-factor authentication is when you're elevating privileges. Very important to make sure we have multi-factor authentication. And we have options for that as well. And then, of course, we need to notify certain users when certain roles are activated so that people know what's happening in the environment. And most importantly, we also need to have an audit history. When a user elevated their permissions, what did they do with those permissions? What activities took place? And you'd be able to have that, and you'd be able to share that with internal, external auditors, et cetera. So from a user experience, just to have an idea of what users might interact with, is a user would come in, they would see a list of roles that they would have access to that they could ask to activate. They would activate it, that would go through an MFA prompt, and then they would have to put in a justification and then maybe an approval for that activation to happen. So there's a couple roles within privileged identity management. This is where I kind of focus now on talking about some of the best practices that'll kind of help us jump through this. So when we look at Azure and we look at Microsoft 365, we essentially have a privileged role administrator. These are the users that are going to assign who can be in what role, who can activate what role. They're very important in this decision-making process as we go through. We have the approvers. These may be managers. They may be in business users. They may be IT, maybe all over the place. There may be more than one. And then we have the eligible role users. These are users that are assigned the ability to activate a role within the environment. And these users all have different levels of permission within the environment. So I'm going into now kind of a design mode where we talk about what are those strategies to start. And I'm going to quickly just go through three quick strategies that really in any privileged access management solution, you can at least take these and start thinking, hey, these are great ways to get started. But also with Azure resources and Microsoft 365 resources, this will kind of give you a quick start on how we might do something with some high level design. So one of the key components, not just of privileged access management, but identity access, especially when we're looking at securing identity access, is to have emergency accounts. And there's some best practices around emergency accounts. A lot of people already know these. A lot of people have not implemented these, however, when I have conversations with them. And it is a good best practice to create emergency accounts, especially in cloud environments where we have the potential of locking ourselves out and not being able to reverse the policy we accidentally implemented and so forth. So there's some best practices around emergency access. When we look at that first design, we need to make sure that our admins are registered for MFA. MFA is crucial to privileged identity management. It's also crucial to identity and access management. And it's really important to look and say, you know what, we need to make sure that all of our admins have multi-factor authentication registered. Obviously, we want to limit their prompts, but we want to make sure that they are using multi-factor authentication when they're doing admin activities. Going through some of those design phased, this deck will be available. I have a link at the end of this that you can download this. We'll kind of start seeing how Microsoft goes to customers and says, hey, how do we need to start designing this? And that first decision is which admin roles are we going to force multi-factor authentication on when that user tries to escalate to those roles? Now, obviously, we want to say all of these right off the bat, but that's not always realistic. We need to look at this and say, what are the main roles that I need to make sure are protected first? And then we can go back and start looking at some of these lower level privileges and maybe make sure that we're doing more than just allowing a user to access privileged access, excuse me. We need to prove we need to decide who has the privileged role administrators. Who is going to set this up? Who's going to manage it, right? It was mentioned earlier, we're trying to govern this, but who's governing it? Who's governing who here, right? So we need to really decide on who are the core people that are going to be able to create these roles, add roles, et cetera, remove roles. All of that needs to be controlled. And of course, that privilege role needs to be an escalated role too and have zero standing access so that you know when things have changed. So I've said zero standing access a lot, and I think that's the key to privilege access management is that we are not giving admins privileged access. They have zero standing access. They have to request it or ask for it somehow, or any type of account that needs to do privileged work or access privileged content needs some level of activation as opposed to just having that. So when we look at zero standing access, we need to look at the different roles in Azure and in Azure AD. These different roles will help us understand essentially what to protect right out of the bat, especially if we're just adopting a policy for privileged access management. Most importantly, Microsoft says to, out of the box, protect your global admins and your security admins. That's the first thing to start with. This can take a matter of hours to a day or two to implement a very quick solution, depending on the organization, and immediately you're going to increase your overall security score, and you're going to lower your risk within your environment just by doing that. And then again, stepping back and looking at, okay, what's next? What are the roles we need to now add into here to make sure that our all of our privileged roles are protected, but always starting with that global admin and security admin roles. The next principle around that is protecting all guest users. Guest users have the ability, these customers, these partners, vendors, the business partners as well, they all have the ability to be privileged within our environment. We want to make sure, especially if they have the need to access privileged content or do privileged activities, that we are protecting all of our guest users immediately. We don't want any external users or external identities having standing access to admin roles. And then another critical component on these decision making is protecting our subscriptions. This doesn't just go for Azure. This is your cloud subscriptions, making sure that you're protecting who can make changes in these critical environments, who can make changes to a subscription at that subscription level is key, because somebody could do a lot of damage if they just had the ability to change some billing information on a subscription. We could really change things, not even messing with the infrastructure itself, but could really have impact on your environment. And of course, last but not least in this scenario is protecting through RBAC. So obviously with roles-based access controls, we have the ability now to control access based on the roles that they already have in our environment. So very easily and quickly, I can just assign a policy to RBAC, and now the users of these groups have the ability to request access to these extended roles. And then quickly, because we're coming up on time, we're going to talk about governance and just a couple of slides to kind of speak about how we do that in Azure AD. And that is done with access reviews. So I had mentioned this, that we need to be able to make sure that the right people have the right access. So this could be as simple as a quarterly, monthly, biannually, annual message, email message that gets sent out to, say, a user's manager that just says simply, does this user still need to have the ability to request to be a global admin, yes or no, click yes, they've got another 30 days, another month, whatever we're trying to give them access to. So we're reviewing these over and over again, and we're allowing us to make sure that we know who in our environment has the right access, especially when we see users move from role to role in the environment and they maintain access to data that they shouldn't have. This happens everywhere, and this is an amazing way, especially from a privileged identity management perspective, to help prevent that. And just one last view of what that looked like from an end user. So as I mentioned, if you want to download this deck, because there are some decision points in here, things that you could use for your own deployment and best practices, feel free. You can do so at the link provided. There's also some links to some future information so that you can learn more. And I absolutely appreciate the time, and I'm going to pass it back to you, Brian. Thank you.